knew that we experienced it almost every other day, and we knew that it included us in this area.
But in order to answer our research question, we need some background research, so we have to start with what this pollution made of. The Headley Index measures several different pollutants in Hong Kong air, and this is a graph showing the average amount of pollutants in Hong Kong air as collected by the Headley Index in the past year. So what is in our air? We've got particulate matter 10, which includes nitrogen oxides, carbon monoxides, and hydrocarbons, nitrogen dioxide, particulate matter 2.5, ozone, and sulfur dioxide.
Pollution has many negative effects. This is a pyramid of the effects of air pollution on the worldwide population. As the graph narrows down, the severity of the effects increase, going from inflammation to death. And as the graph broadens up, the magnitude of the impact increases, going from affecting thousands of people to millions of people. According to Hong Kong University's Headley Index, in 2016, there were 5 premature deaths every day in Hong Kong due to the air pollution. Air pollution not only affects our health, but it also affects the environment. When there's too much pollution in the atmosphere, the rain turns acidic and then falls to the soil and oceans, and therefore affects the wildlife that inhabits it.
So as seen in this pie chart provided by the Hong Kong government, these are the sources of pollution in Hong Kong, air pollution in Hong Kong. And navigation has the largest impact on the total air pollution, where any kind of air pollution created by marine transport, such as cruises and cargo ships, while road transport mainly includes private cars, public transport, and delivery vehicles. And these vehicles usually emit carbon, nitrogen, or particulate emission. While public electricity generation is usually fueled by oil, gas, and coal, which creates a variety of pollutants. And finally, non-combustive pollutants are usually created through the usage of inks, printing inks, paints, and also associated solvents.
Hong Kong has been trying to reduce its pollution for many years now, but it just doesn't seem to be working. So we look at some other solutions such as waste energy and landfill gas energy, urban planning, urban gardening, and reducing vehicle emissions.
So what is waste energy and landfill gas energy? Both of these are strategies the Hong Kong government is already planning on implementing. Waste energy is essentially an incinerator, where trash that's meant to go to a landfill is burned to create energy. This could replace fossil fuels. Also, landfill gas energy is when landfill gas is collected from landfills, is treated, and then burned to create energy. Hong Kong government is planning on building 2 of these facilities. So what are the benefits of these strategies? Well, both of them reduce the amount of methane in the air. Methane is a greenhouse gas that's 30 times more potent than carbon dioxide. And also they both can replace fossil fuels. So also waste to energy can reduce the amounts of space needed for landfills, which as Hong Kong is like, there's a lot of space that we can use to build other housing. However, there are a lot of downfalls to these both of these strategies. Waste to energy releases carcinogenic gases, which cause cancer and harm us. And landfill gas releases carbon dioxide. So overall, these aren't really that great for the environment either. Also, both of these strategies are not very cost effective. So overall, the downfalls outweigh the benefits.
Another solution we looked at was urban planning. And urban planning is the design and regulation of space that focuses on physical form, economic function, and social impact. And so this solution would be very effective for pedestrians because it focuses on ventilation, because in this picture, this is called the street canyon effect. And so the wind goes over the buildings and the pollutants that are made by the cars are stuck inside this air hole, it seems like here, where the pedestrians are walking. And this is proven by this graph here where the orange is the pollution on the streets and the blue is the pollution on the buildings. And so this solution would be very, very effective, but it would take a long time and a lot of money, so not that impact.
Another solution we looked at was urban gardening. Urban gardening is the practice of cultivating greens in cities to provide food for personal well-being, or even to help purify small amount of air. Some of the benefits of the solution is by growing our own produce, we can ensure that there will be no pesticides or harmful plants in our foods. And also it indirectly helps save money by avoiding any unnecessary trips to the grocery store for both individuals and companies. Also another benefit is that through photosynthesis,
from the previous pie chart from the beginning of the presentation, you can see that vehicle emissions has a great impact on the total amount of air pollution. So from these charts provided by Professor Cao Wang, who works for the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, we can see that buses and medium to heavy goods trucks contribute about or more than 50% of the total emission. And this is because most trucks and buses aren't owned by the government, and rather they're owned by private companies. Thus, these companies have their own say on, like, and their own decision on how many service vehicles and on the road there is, and also the type of engines they use. So the aim of this solution is to actually regulate the engines and also equip a catalytic converter on them. But the problem with this is that changing the engine and also equipping the catalytic converter is a really costly procedure, and also it doesn't address the sulfur dioxide level.
So in our question, in our research question, we say that we want to find the most effective solution. So how do we define effective? We define effective as the biggest impact in the shortest amount of time.
And the solution that best fit our definition of effective was reducing vehicular emissions.
So how does this solution work?
So previously, the government had already tried carrying out certain aspects of this the solution, which includes implementing new engines for buses and also equipping catalytic converters on trucks, and also providing a full subsidy for both of the plants. But the problem is no one was willing to change.
So we wanted to implement three main policies, the first one being engine regulations. As seen in this graph, newer engines create much less emissions than older engines.
This includes both buses and trucks. As seen here, pre-Euro has like a way higher amount of emissions, and most trucks in Hong Kong are actually pre-Euro models, while for buses, they haven't changed since 2014. But their models are still stuck at Euro 4 rather than 5 or 6.
The other two solutions would be to reduce the amount of buses in the streets. As private companies own Hong Kong's public transportation, there can be up to 6,000 buses in the streets, and not all of them are in service, and many have overlapping routes. So by reducing the amount of buses and trucks in the streets, the amount of pollution can be greatly reduced. Also, by adding catalytic converters, they can capture about 30 to 40% of the emissions coming out of buses.
The effect of the solution is that it halves the total amount of total road transportation emissions, which therefore creates much cleaner street level air.
And as you can see in this graph here, the new engines have a major decrease in pollutants compared to the older engines that are being used on the street today.
So although our main solution is to actually push for the reduction of vehicle emissions, Hong Kong should also consider other solutions, as implementing other solutions can also help create a greener city.
These are image citations.
These are information citations.
Uh-huh. All right. Elliot, I'll start on your side this time. Can you give me an example of something that another teammate wrote in their report that impacted your thinking about this topic?
Well, I read about Maya's landfill gas burning for energy report, and how it was how the government was actually doing something rather than just sitting there and just hiding from the companies, and that actually changed how I wrote my plan on the engine emissions.
All right, great. Maya, if the team had more time, where do you think you guys would go next? Like, what would you look at next?
We only took out like 4 or 5 solutions, and I think we would try and look at a variety of different solutions, go more in depth, as well as look greater into like the government part in this, because we didn't push too hard from it.
Okay. Vincent, can you talk about something that was contained in one of the individual research reports that the group decided not to include in the presentation?
That wasn't included?
Yeah. Did you guys have to choose to leave something out?
Not really. We really didn't choose anything to leave out, because each of us kind of described our solution getting there. Mm-hmm. But then we definitely knew that vehicle emissions was the best strategy to use.
And Claire, can you give an example of something that worked well in this group that maybe in past groups that you were in